The decision of who should get tested for COVID-19 is not an easy one. The main reason is because as of right now, there aren't many tests available. Last time I checked the CDC, that number is around 80,000 or so, and probably more by the time you're watching this video because they're ramping up production. When reporters asked President Trump and Vice President Pence about testing, their response was, "Anyone in this country who needs a test can get a test." Well, that's not true because I can tell you from firsthand experience, if I want to test someone, it first has to be approved by the State Department of Health. And this is the case with thousands of other doctors in this country. Why is this the case? Because there's only so many tests available. Yes, there are more and more tests being made, but there's still not enough. You see, South Korea was prepared before the virus hit them. When they saw the outbreak start in December in 2019, back in Wuhan, they immediately got the RNA genetic code of the virus from the Chinese. And a private company in South Korea started working on developing the PCR test before the virus hit South Korea. That's why they were able to test so many people so quickly. And that's also why their case fatality rate was so low, because they were testing so many people, not just the sickest people. By identifying those who had it, they could isolate them and minimize the spread there. But the US has had more than 2 months to prepare, but we were not prepared, and we don't have enough tests. There are four main reasons for that. One is the current administration drastically reduced our public health infrastructure, and 2 years ago, the CDC stopped funding epidemic prevention activities in 39 countries, including China. At that time, former CDC director Dr. Tom Frieden said the move would significantly increase the chance an epidemic will spread without our knowledge and endanger lives in our country and around the world. Well, it looks like he nailed that prediction. All right, the second reason why there's not that many tests is because there were malfunctions in the initial test kits, which led to delays in manufacturing. Number three is about 5 weeks ago, we could have used the WHO tests, but for whatever reason, those were rejected. And number four, in the beginning, unlike South Korea, we did not have private companies making testing kits. But we can't rewrite the past, so in the here and the now, moving forward, we have to be selective in who we test. The CDC says it's the physician's clinical judgment in terms of who gets tested. But that's only partially true because, like I said, I still need approval from the State Department of Health before I test someone. And this has already happened to me several times. And that's a common frustration among all of us doctors on the front lines. The way most physicians are deciding on who to test falls into one of the four following scenarios. So let's say a person has a fever, which is the most common symptom, about 95% of patients. And or let's say they have lower respiratory tract symptoms, such as a dry cough, or possibly even shortness of breath. So let's say they've had those symptoms within the previous 14 days, and they've had close contact with a confirmed or suspected case of COVID-19. And this includes in the healthcare setting. And if you want to define what is a close contact, well, that means within about 6 feet of someone for a prolonged period of time while not wearing personal protective equipment, or if you're in close contact with the infectious secretions for a prolonged period of time without wearing the PPE. Okay, so the second category of who should get tested is someone who's had the symptoms such as the fever, dry cough, fatigue, any of those, and it's been occurring within the previous 14 days, and they have residence in or travel to a hotspot area, meaning where widespread community transmission has been reported. So this would include China, South Korea, Japan, Iran, and most of Europe, especially Italy. Within the United States, this would especially mean New York City, the state of Washington, Colorado, California, and others. The third category of who should get tested would be people who've had those symptoms that I just mentioned within 14 days, and they had potential exposure through attendance at a large event or spending time in specific settings where COVID-19 cases have been reported. And then the fourth category of who should get tested would be someone who has severe lower respiratory tract symptoms. This would include severe shortness of breath with low oxygen levels, severe cough, and findings of pneumonia on the CAT scan, and you're not able to come up with an alternative diagnosis. So this is for the clinicians out there. So if someone comes in and they have lung symptoms that are severe, that's causing them to have low oxygen levels, hypoxia, and you can't find an alternative diagnosis, that's someone who should be considered for COVID-19 testing. Now, I want to take a look at the following scenario. Let's say someone is at home, they have a little bit of fever, maybe they feel a little fatigued, perhaps they even have a dry cough. Well, that could be the common cold, It could also be COVID-19, and in some cases, those symptoms could be a mild version of the flu, which is exactly what just happened to my uncle, who had those very mild symptoms and ended up being positive for the flu. But based on those symptoms alone, it could be, like I said, the common cold, COVID-19, or the flu. Sometimes it's even severe allergies that can overlap with these symptoms. So the only way to know is to do the test with a nasal and oral swab. But if someone is only having mild symptoms, is it really worth sending that person to the hospital or clinic to get tested? Because if you do that, you'll likely spread the disease there, or at least risk spreading the disease there. And that means spreading the disease to people who are already sick with other illnesses, and those other patients are vulnerable to getting this disease. And they're also vulnerable to getting sicker from the disease. The other thing you do when you do that is you're risking spreading the disease to healthcare workers. And healthcare workers need to be protected from illness, because if we become ill, who's left to take care of others who are ill? And this is why drive-through diagnostic testing is great, but there aren't that many that exist. This past week in cities in California, Colorado, Connecticut, Minnesota, New York, and Texas, and the state of Washington, they've opened drive-through coronavirus testing stations, emulating what the South Koreans did. People can drive up and be swabbed without having to leave their car. But before doing so, they need at least a doctor's note or a phone call with a doctor's approval. And these tests are free in most, if not all, of these locations. Healthcare workers in personal protective gear take a driver's temperature, they check for breathing difficulties, and they swab the passenger to get a sample that the worker sends to a nearby lab. So far, the United States has run an estimated 20,000 number of tests total. In comparison, South Korea was running 10,000 tests per day. But the plan is for more and more drive-throughs to be set up, which will allow for faster testing and will also ultimately help to slow the spread of the virus. Just remember, the most common symptoms are fever, fatigue, and dry cough, but some people might not have any symptoms. The most concerning symptom is shortness of breath, and that is the biggest reason why someone should seek medical attention.